Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs. Abraham Lincoln, A Life, by Michael Burlingame. Lincoln's frontier background shapes the future president, 1809 to 1837. Read by Sean Pratt. Chapter 1. I have seen a good deal of the backside of this world. Childhood in Kentucky, 1809 to 1816. One day in the middle of the Civil War, Abraham Lincoln stole time from his busy schedule to pen some wise paternal advice to a young Union captain who had been squabbling with his superiors. Quoting from Hamlet, the president wrote that a father's admonition to his son, "Beware of entrance to a quarrel, but being in, bear it that the opposed may beware of thee," was good counsel. And yet, not the best. Instead, Lincoln enjoined the captain, "Quarrel not at all." The reasons Lincoln gave were practical. No man resolved to make the most of himself can spare time for personal contention. Still less can he afford to take all the consequences, including the vitiating of his temper and the loss of self-control. Yield larger things to which you can show no more than equal right, and yield lesser ones, though clearly your own. Better give your path to a dog than be bitten by him in contesting for the right. Even killing the dog would not cure the bite. Born in emotional and economic poverty, Lincoln early on resolved to make the most of himself, and did so, adhering to those precepts. Ancestry. Like many exceptional children of unexceptional parents, Lincoln was quite curious about his ancestors, especially his grandfathers, neither of whom he knew. He was so intrigued that he planned to conduct genealogical research after he left the presidency. In 1858, when asked about his forebears, he revealed more than a passing acquaintance with his family tree. "I believe the first of our ancestors we know anything about was Samuel Lincoln, who came from Norwich, England, in 1638, and settled in a small Massachusetts place called Hingham, or it might have been called Hangham." Lincoln loved wordplay. In two brief autobiographical sketches written for the campaign of 1860, he devoted much space to his lineage. The following year, Lincoln told a Yorkshireman that he planned to visit England, the home of his ancestors. His father's father was known as Captain Abraham, a rank he attained in 1776 while serving in the Virginia militia. Born in 1744 in Pennsylvania, the future captain moved with his father, John, and the rest of their family to the Shenandoah Valley of Virginia around 1766. They settled along Linville Creek in Augusta, later Rockingham County, where John Lincoln farmed a tract of 600 acres, one-third of which he sold to his son Abraham in 1773. The following year, Abraham participated in Lord Dunmore's expedition against the Shawnees, and during the Revolution he joined General Lachlan McIntosh's feudal campaign against Fort Detroit. For unknown reasons, in 1780, the captain departed with his wife and children on a 250-mile trek to the remote and dangerous Indian hunting grounds of Kentucky, while the Revolutionary War still raged and attacks on settlers were common. In 1784 alone, Indians killed more than 100 migrants traveling the Wilderness Road from Virginia to Kentucky, which was little more than a trail first blazed by Daniel Boone in 1775. Perhaps Grandfather Abraham wished to avoid taxes, or he may have been lured westward by the prospect of easy gains in land speculation. His decision to sell a large farm in western Virginia for paper money showed bad judgment because the soil there was so fertile that German pioneer settlers had made the area highly productive. Captain Abraham's inability to thrive in Virginia suggests that he may have been shiftless. Captain Abraham died a violent death on the dark and bloody ground of frontier Kentucky. As a boy, the future president often heard this harrowing tale, which he called the legend more strongly than all others imprinted upon my mind and memory. Working his farm one spring day in 1786, the 42-year-old grandfather Abraham was ambushed by an Indian, who shot him dead before the terrified eyes of his young son, Thomas, father-to-be of the 16th president. As the Indian prepared to kidnap the lad, his older brother, Mordecai, dashed back to the family cabin, grabbed a rifle, aimed at the silver ornament dangling from the Indian's neck, and squeezed the trigger. Luckily for Thomas, his brother's aim was true and the boy escaped unharmed, at least physically. The Indian may have belonged to a tribe the captain had battled during his militia service. Lincoln's opinion of his namesake grandfather is not recorded, but he may well have admired him. Some gifted children with disappointing fathers romanticized their grandfathers, even if they scarcely knew them. In an 1861 speech to New Jersey legislators, Lincoln paid glowing tribute to the soldiers of the Revolution, and Captain Abraham may have been a lifelong source of inspiration to Lincoln as he strove to make the most of himself. In a campaign biography that Lincoln himself read and corrected, William Dean Howells asserted that his subject had the stubborn notion that because the Lincolns had always been people of excellent sense, he, a Lincoln, might become a person of distinction. What Lincoln knew about his other grandfather is hard to say. Lincoln once described him as a Virginia planter or a large farmer who took sexual advantage of a poor, credulous young woman named Lucy Hanks, granddaughter of William Lee, a plantation overseer accused of beating a slave to death. The fruit of that union was Nancy Hanks, mother of the future president. From this aristocratic progenitor, Lincoln believed that he inherited his power of analysis, his logic, his mental activity, his ambition, and all the qualities that distinguished him from the other members and descendants of the Hanks family. This grandfather's identity, unknown to history, may well have been known to Lincoln, who was acquainted with several members of the Hanks family, including two great aunts who had been born in Virginia before or during the Revolution, and also his great-uncle Billy Hanks, father of Lincoln's rail-splitting partner, John Hanks. The Hankses played a long-lasting role in Lincoln's life, caring for his beloved stepmother until her death in 1869. It seems likely that the Hanks family would have shared with Abe what they knew about Nancy Hanks's father. Lincoln's description of his aristocratic grandsire represents a variation of the family romance phenomenon, which causes some children to speculate that they are actually the offspring of more distinguished parents than the ones who raised them. Most people outgrow these fantasies, but some adults, including exceptional people or men with very distant fathers, tend to maintain an unusually strong sense of family romance throughout life. Lincoln fits this category on both counts, for he was truly exceptional and had a distant relationship with his father. Father Thomas. Lincoln's father, Thomas, was quite undistinguished. As his son later wrote, by the early death of his father and very narrow circumstances of his mother, even in childhood, Thomas was a wandering, laboring boy. Born around 1776 in Virginia's Shenandoah Valley, he moved with his parents and four siblings to Kentucky in 1780. Finding most land in the fertile bluegrass region already taken, the Lincolns pushed on to the hard-scrabble terrain between the Cumberland and Green Rivers, where they established a farm. Later, evidently fearing hostile Indians in that remote locale, they moved to a site on Long Run in Jefferson County. There they lived in a stockade, 18 miles from Louisville. After Captain Abraham's death, his widow, Bathsheba, and their children resettled in Washington County, where they would be safer. Bathsheba later stayed with her daughter Nancy, wife of William Brumfield, who owned a large farm near Hardinsburg in Breckinridge County. After Bathsheba's son, Thomas, bought a farm in 1803 on Mill Creek, she and the Brumfields moved in. 3 years later, the Brumfields purchased 225 acres a few miles to the north, where they built a log house. Bathsheba, the shrewdest and most intelligent member of the family, prodded both her rather lazy son-in-law and young Thomas, hiring the latter out for good wages. The documentary record reveals little about Thomas's activities in the decade after his father's death. Under the law of primogeniture, his eldest son, Mordecai, inherited everything from the paternal estate, which included a few hundred acres in Kentucky. Mordecai may have treated his younger brother unkindly. Emily Todd Helm, half-sister of Mary Todd Lincoln, said that the reason why Thomas Lincoln grew up unlettered was that his brother Mordecai, having all the land in his possession, turned Thomas out of the house when the latter was 12 years old, so he went out among his relations and the Berries and others, and there grew up. In 1795, Thomas served in the Kentucky militia for a month, and the following year he worked on a mill dam in Hardin County. While laboring there, he lived with his father's cousin, Hananiah Lincoln, a resident of Elizabethtown, 45 miles southwest of Louisville. Thomas and Hananiah remained in that village only until 1789, when they evidently headed south to Cumberland County. While in that region, Thomas spent time in Tennessee with his prosperous uncle, Isaac Lincoln, whose only child had died quite young. Thomas might have become a surrogate son, but Isaac disapproved of young Tom's indolence and improvidence. Returning to Kentucky the following year, Thomas shuttled back and forth between Washington and Cumberland counties. In 1802, he moved to Hardin County, where his name appeared on the tax lists for the next 14 years. In 1803, he purchased a 238-acre farm on Mill Creek where he lived while working in nearby Elizabethtown, a hamlet whose population in 1810 numbered 181. How Thomas could afford to buy that farm is unclear. Perhaps his brother Mordecai shared some of his patrimony with him after Thomas attained his majority, or Thomas may have purchased the Mill Creek property with the savings his mother had set aside from the wages he earned when she hired him out. 3 years after he bought the Mill Creek farm, Thomas journeyed to New Orleans. On June 12, 1806, shortly after returning from Louisiana, he married Nancy Hanks in a ceremony that took place near Poor Town in Washington County. Following a brief honeymoon, the newlyweds moved to Elizabethtown, where their first child, Sarah, was born less than 8 months after her parents' wedding. A journalist described their residence as a shed, almost bare of household fittings and quite unfit for a human dwelling place. Why the couple did not live on the Mill Creek property is a mystery. Nancy, perhaps, wished to be closer to her family than to her husband's relatives. She may have been lonely in Elizabethtown, where she had no kin, and perhaps for that reason, at the end of 1807, Thomas moved 14 miles to a rock-strewn spread in the Barrens, on the South Fork of Nolan Creek, known as the Sinking Spring Farm. It was near the homestead where Thomas and Betsy Sparrow, who raised Nancy, lived with their foster child, Dennis Hanks, and where Nancy's aunt Polly Hanks' friend had settled. Thomas gambled when he chose that site, for rather than a deed, he purchased a title bond, an assignment of someone's contested right to the land. He would own the property only if others met their financial obligations. Dennis Hanks, a cousin who lived with the Lincolns for 3 years during Abe's youth, reported that Thomas couldn't make a living by his trade of carpentry. There was scarcely any money in the country. So Tom took up some land, mighty poor land, but the best he could get when he hadn't much to trade for it. Thomas Lincoln may have left Elizabethtown for Nolan Creek because he believed his reputation as a carpenter had been damaged when an influential citizen sued him for shoddy work. The nearest settlement, 2.5 miles to the south, was in the vicinity of Hodgins Mill. On February 12, 1809, in a cabin that an observer called a miserable habitation, Nancy delivered a baby boy, who was named Abraham, after Thomas's father. The Lincolns remained in Kentucky until 1816, when they removed to Indiana. There, Nancy Hanks Lincoln died 2 years later. Thomas remarried in 1819, and 11 years afterwards, he moved to Illinois, where he would remain until his death in 1851. He had known more than his fair share of hardship and sorrow. Thomas Lincoln shared only a few things in common with his son. Both were able wrestlers, as well as good-natured, humorous, and gifted storytellers. A surviving example of Thomas's humor concerns his second wife, who allegedly remarked one day, "We have lived together a long time and you have never told me whom you like best, your first wife or me." He responded, "Oh, now, Sarah, that reminds me of old John Harden down in Kentucky who had a fine-looking pair of horses, and a neighbor coming in one day and looking at them said, 'John, which horse do you like best?' John replied, 'I can't tell. One of them kicks and the other bites, and I don't know which is worst.'" But the qualities that would make Abraham Lincoln famous, his intellectual power, ambition, idealism, eloquence, spirituality, integrity, political wisdom, judgment, leadership, were lacking in Thomas. Henry C. Whitney, to whom Lincoln described his childhood, said that from Thomas Lincoln his son inherited only infancy, ignorance, and indigence. Few of Thomas's neighbors could remember anything special about him other than that he was a plain, unpretending, plodding man, a good, average man, who attended to his work, and was among the very commonest of the plain pioneers, honest and harmless, illiterate, yet always truthful, conscientious, and religious, and peaceable good. Thomas evidently could read a little, but was unable to write anything other than his signature. Unlike his tall, rangy son, Thomas was thick, weighing between 180 and 200 pounds. He was a bit stoop-shouldered, somewhat clumsy as he walked, and strong. Dennis Hanks found it remarkable that Thomas, though not a fleshy man, was built so compact that it was difficult to find or feel a rib in his body. Thomas had dark gray eyes, a low forehead, heavy eyebrows, a sharp chin, and an unusually big Roman nose, which was his most prominent feature. He was indifferent to clothes, and his taste in food was simple, two traits he also shared with his son. "His whole appearance," said one neighbor, "denoted a man of small intellect and less ambition, and such he was." If Thomas lacked intellectual power and driving ambition, he impressed people favorably as honest and sociable, slow to take offense, with a lot of common sense. Though he seldom had a cross word for anyone, he did use profanity occasionally. When his young daughter repeated an oath of his, he received a scolding from his wife and never swore again. One day during his presidency, Lincoln used the expression, "by jings," while visiting the telegraph office. When asked about that expression, he apologized to the operators for his profanity, explaining that, "by jings is swearing, for my good old mother taught me that anything that had a by before it is swearing." When Lincoln's friend William G. Green visited Thomas in 1836, he found his manners backwoodsish, but was charmed by his wit and humor and thought him a mighty hospitable and a very entertaining host. For all his humor, Thomas could be taciturn and moody. He often became depressed and withdrew into himself, sometimes wandering out in the barrens for hours on end. Bouts of depression would hardly be surprising in a man who, as a boy, had witnessed his father's murder, and then endured wandering, rootless poverty, and hard labor. Other losses, recurring financial setbacks, and the deaths of his second son in 1813, of his wife in 1818, and of his daughter in 1828, deepened his dejection. He frequently said, "Everything that I ever touched either died, got killed, or was lost." On other occasions, he lamented, "It's the hand of Providence laid upon me." Thomas's susceptibility to depression may have been, in part, genetic. His brother Mordecai and his sons were known as men who at a time communed with themselves, absorbed in their own thoughts. Prone to melancholia, depression, and gloomy spells called the horrors, Mordecai allegedly would come into his mother's house and sit down for long periods of time without saying a word, unless it were to mutter an oath against something or curse somebody. He would sometimes take up his violin and pace the floor. The horrors resembled bouts of delirium tremens and may in fact have been the result of heavy drinking, for he reportedly exercised the privilege very common in those days of indulging freely whenever he pleased, which happened very often. He also betrayed signs of paranoia, accusing Catholics of stealing his father's land, and over time his hatred of Roman priests intensified. Many other members of the family had moody spells. Mary Rowena Lincoln, mother of Thomas's nephew James Lincoln, was reportedly a victim of the Lincoln hippo, that is, hypo or depression. Benjamin Mudd, son of Elizabeth Lincoln Mudd, suffered from what was called the Lincoln horrors. An uncle of Thomas's confessed to a court that he suffered from a deranged mind. Another relative in the same area, Mary Jane Lincoln, was committed to the Illinois Hospital for the Insane after a court hearing in which a jury determined that the disease is with her hereditary. She had gone insane in 1854 at the age of 26, was committed to the state asylum in 1867, and died there 21 years later. Thomas Lincoln prospered neither as a carpenter nor a farmer. He learned woodworking from Nancy Hanks's uncle, Joseph Hanks Jr., and made his living as a cabinet and house carpenter until he wed. Thereafter, he supplemented his income by farming. His carpentry skills were so rudimentary that people called him a rough and cheap carpenter, who could only put doors, windows, and floors in log houses and do a tolerable job of joining. He continued working as a carpenter after he moved to Indiana, making tables, coffins, doors, and window casings. He worked when jobs came to him, but would not seek them out. Some customers were unhappy with his work. In 1807, Denton Gehagen of Elizabethtown refused to pay Thomas for hewing timbers for his sawmill. Some timbers were too short, others too long. Thomas sued for his fee and won. Thomas was even less successful as a farmer, partly because he chose unpromising land to till. The Nolan Creek property, birthplace of the future president, had poor soil except in a few small patches. When, in 1811, Thomas abandoned that farm, after the owner took title and refused to lease the property to him, he moved to equally unpromising terrain on Knob Creek, 9 miles away. In 1816, he attempted to make a fresh start in Indiana, and, unwisely, selected 160 heavily timbered acres. He also built his cabin more than a mile from a reliable water source. He showed similarly bad judgment in Illinois in the 1830s and 1840s. Even if he had selected land more shrewdly, Thomas lacked the industry, ambition, and intellect to prosper. As Dennis Hanks put it, Thomas was a man who took the world easy and never thought that gold was God. Hanks's son-in-law was more blunt. Thomas, he declared, was very careless about his business, a poor manager, at times accumulated considerable property which he always managed to make way with about as fast as he made it, and was what is generally called an unlucky man in business. In 1835, Thomas and four partners leased a mill for a year. When they failed to pay the agreed-upon rent, they were successfully sued. Several times Thomas took boatloads of pork and other goods down the Mississippi River to New Orleans, usually making little money. In a particularly unfortunate transaction, he was cheated out of the entire load. His son Abraham described that calamity. Father often told me of the trick that was played upon him by a pair of sharpers. It was in 1815, the year before we moved from Kentucky to Indiana, that Father concluded to take a load of pork down to New Orleans. He had a considerable amount of his own, and he bargained with the relatives and neighbors for the pork, so that altogether he had quite a load. He took the pork to the Ohio River on a clumsily constructed flatboat of his own make. Almost as soon as he pushed out into the river, a couple of sleek fellows bargained with him for his cargo and promised to meet him in New Orleans, where they arranged to pay him the price agreed upon. He eagerly accepted the offer, transferred the cargo to the strangers, and drifted down the river, his head filled with visions of wealth and delight. He thought that he was going to accomplish what he had set out to do without labor or inconvenience. Father waited about New Orleans for several days, but failed to meet his whilom friends. At last it dawned upon him that he had been sold, and all that he could do was to come back home and face the music. Thomas Lincoln also lost money buying and selling farms, especially in Kentucky, where an archaic surveying system, which permitted claims to be identified by trees, stones, creek bends, and other such imprecise landmarks, produced chaos, leading to innumerable lawsuits. Kentucky law did not require a qualifying examination for surveyors, who reportedly were never correct except by accident. Years later, Lincoln recalled how Kentuckians used to be troubled with mysterious relics of feudalism, and titles got into such an almighty mess with these pettifogging encumbrances turning up at every fresh trading with the land, and no one knowing how to get rid of them. Because the size of the Mill Creek farm was unclear, Thomas was able to sell it for only £100, though he had paid £118 for it a decade earlier. For $200, he purchased a title bond to the 300-acre Nolan Creek farm and lost it all, including the value of the improvements he had made on the property. He was ejected from the 30-acre Knob Creek farm, which he had leased, not purchased. Memories of his family's trouble with land titles may have predisposed Lincoln to become a surveyor and a lawyer. As an attorney, he advised young men aspiring to the bar, "Never stir up litigation. A worse man can scarcely be found than one who does this. Who can be more nearly a fiend than he who habitually overhauls the register of deeds in search of defects and titles, whereon to stir up strife and put money in his pocket?" Thomas fared just as badly in Indiana. First, he squatted on a 160-acre tract of government land for 10 months and then bought it, on credit, for $320. Thomas probably delayed making a down payment for the same reason that most pioneers did: lack of cash. In 1817, he put down $80, but over the following decade, he made no further payments. In 1827, he relinquished half the farm, reducing his debt to $80, which he met by turning over to the government title to 80 acres in a distant county, a property that he had mysteriously acquired 4 weeks earlier. In 1830, he sold this $160 farm for $125. When, a decade later, Thomas found himself unable to meet obligations he had assumed for 4 parcels of Illinois land, his generous son Abraham gave him what amounted to a gift of $200 for a 50-acre tract that had cost Thomas only $50. Shortly thereafter, Abraham again rescued his father by paying off a mortgage that Thomas had assumed. Thomas made scant use of the land he occupied, usually clearing only a few acres for a garden and a corn patch. At Knob Creek, he cultivated only 6 acres along the creek in a strip about 40 feet wide on either side. He worked enough to sustain life, and no more. For the most part, Thomas avoided the market economy, remaining a subsistence farmer. He did, however, grow a little tobacco, which he peddled for 10 cents a pound. On at least one occasion, he offered that commodity to satisfy a debt on a horse he had bought on credit. The creditor, impressed that a man would part with his tobacco to pay what he owed, forgave the $10. According to Thomas's stepson-in-law, John J. Hall, Thomas Lincoln did not improve with age nor with increasing responsibilities. He was still the same kind and genial fellow, but grew more and more shiftless and good for nothing as the years rolled on. At the rocky Nolan Creek farm, Hall reported, he did not cultivate the soil nor fix up the old shanty. In Illinois, Tom, along with his stepson, John D. Johnston, and Johnston's 5 sons, tilled only 40 of their 120 acres. In an area where the average farm was worth $1,600, Tom valued his farm at $100 in the 1850 census, even though he was older than his neighbors, had had time to accumulate more property, and had a large number of family hands to work the land. Thomas ranked behind 79% of his neighbors in terms of wealth. George B. Balk, an Illinois neighbor, noted that while most farmers took their crops to market in a wagon, Tom Lincoln used a basket or a large tray. Balk characterized Thomas as uneducated, illiterate, and contented with a from-hand-to-mouth living. In sum, an excellent specimen of poor white trash, rough, lazy, and worthless. He owned a few sheep behind which he talked and walked slow. Balk added that several anecdotes of his ignorance and singularity might be related, but we forbear. Other neighbors agreed with Balk's assessment of Thomas Lincoln. In Indiana, Nathaniel Grigsby called Thomas a piddler, always doing, but doing nothing great. He wanted few things and supplied them easily. William E. Grigsby regarded Thomas as no account. Robert Mitchell Thompson of Kentucky, whose mother was a cousin of Nancy Hanks, reported that Thomas Lincoln was always poor and was all the time going hunting or roaming around, not satisfied to stay long in any one place. Still others testified that Thomas was rather indolent and improvident, had an aversion to work, and was careless and inert and dull. William G. Green spent time at the Lincoln's farm in Goose Nest Prairie in Coles County, Illinois, and observed that Thomas was barely able to eke out a living. Green found Thomas residing in a little cabin that cost perhaps $15, and with many evidences of poverty about him. The cabin looked so small and humble that Green felt embarrassed. It had no stable, no outhouse, and no shrubbery or trees. An early historian of Coles County, who interviewed acquaintances of Thomas Lincoln, called him one of those easy, honest, commonplace men who took life as they find it, and, as a consequence, generally find it a life of poverty. He possessed no faculty whatever of preserving his money when he had made any, hence he always remained poor. He was easily contented, had few wants, and those of a primitive nature. He was a foe to intemperance, strictly honest, and supposing others the same, often suffered pecuniary losses. Sophie Hanks, who lived in the Lincoln family's Indiana cabin for several years, had a son who attributed Thomas's lack of ambition to frontier isolation. "He was like the other people in that country. None of them worked to get ahead. There wasn't no market for nothing unless you took it across two or three states. The people raised just what they needed." Thomas preferred hunting to farming. Dennis Hanks recalled, "We all hunted pretty much all the time, especially so when we got tired of work, which was very often, I will assure you." Such behavior was common on the Midwestern frontier. A Northeasterner who moved to central Illinois described the inhabitants there as destitute of any energy or enterprise, and their labors and attention being chiefly confined to the hunting of game. In sketches of pioneer life in that same locale, Francis Grierson portrayed a representative farmer, Zach Caverly, who explained, "My old daddy learnt me to go through this sorrin' vale like the varmints do, easy and natural-like, never gallopin' when you can lope, and never lopin' when you can lie down. It's a heap easier." Thomas, in short, was a classic southern backcountry cracker, a term originating in northern Britain. Often of Celtic background, crackers were famously easygoing, improvident, unacquisitive, lazy, and restless. They preferred to spend their days hunting, fishing, and loafing rather than farming. They had little use for education and were often illiterate. Their folk ways and culture derived largely from northern England, Scotland, Ireland, Wales, Cornwall, and the Hebrides. Abraham Lincoln's view of his father's indolence is unrecorded, but he did scold his stepbrother John D. Johnston for that flaw in letters that may reflect his attitude not only toward Johnston, but also toward Thomas Lincoln. In 1848, when Johnston asked him for a loan, Lincoln declined, saying, "At the various times when I have helped you a little, you have said to me, 'We can get along very well now, but in a very short time I find you in the same difficulty again. Now this can only happen by some defect in your conduct. What that defect is, I think I know. You are not lazy, and still you are an idler. I doubt whether since I saw you, you have done a good whole day's work in any one day. You do not very much dislike so to work, and still you do not work much, merely because it does not seem to you that you could get much for it. This habit of uselessly wasting time is the whole difficulty, and it is vastly important to you, and still more so your children, that you should break this habit. When Johnston, who was born tired, proposed to leave Illinois for Missouri, Lincoln scolded him in language that could well have applied to his peripatetic father. Such a notion is utterly foolish. What can you do in Missouri better than here in Illinois? Is the land any richer? Can you there, any more than here, raise corn and wheat and oats without work? Will anybody there, any more than here, do your work for you? If you intend to go to work, there is no better place than right where you are. If you do not intend to go to work, you cannot get along anywhere. Squirming and crawling about from place to place can do no good. You have raised no crop this year, and what you really want is to sell the land, get the money, and spend it. Part with the land you have, and my life upon it, you will never after own a spot big enough to bury you in. Half you will get for the land you spend in moving to Missouri, and the other half you will eat and drink, and wear out, and no foot of land will be bought. Now I feel it is my duty to have no hand in such a piece of foolery. Thomas Lincoln's indolence, lack of ambition, and disdain for education put him at odds with his smart, enterprising son. Thomas, Abraham said, grew up literally without education, and never did more in the way of writing than to bunglingly sign his own name. This patronizing language lends credence to the testimony of Dennis Hanks, who called Lincoln a mother's boy, and doubted whether Abe loved his father very well or not, and concluded, "I don't think he did." The feeling was mutual. According to Augustus H. Chapman, Dennis Hanks's son-in-law, Thomas Lincoln never showed by his actions that he thought much of his son Abraham when a boy. He treated him rather unkind, and always appeared to think much more of his stepson, John D. Johnston, than he did of his own son Abraham. This preference is not surprising, for Thomas shared much in common with his improvident stepson. Lincoln's aversion to his father persisted into adulthood. He never once invited Thomas or his wife to Springfield during the entire 24-year span Lincoln lived there. He rarely lent money to his cash-strapped sire. When his law practice took him near his father's home in Coles County, Illinois, Lincoln stayed with Dennis Hanks rather than under the paternal roof. As Thomas lay dying in 1851, his 41-year-old son refused his deathbed appeal for a visit. Lincoln icily enjoined his stepbrother to tell their father that if we could meet now, it is doubtful whether it would not be more painful than pleasant. After Thomas died, Lincoln failed to attend the funeral, nor did he have a tombstone placed on the grave. Lincoln did not name a son after his father until after Thomas's death. He belittled his father when, referring to one of Thomas's brothers, he told a friend, "I have often said that Uncle Mord had run off with all the talents of the family." Lincoln's estrangement stemmed not just from Thomas's emotional reserve, painful though it may have been. More deeply wounding was his father's cold and inhuman treatment of him. Caroline Dahl, who spoke with William H. Herndon, Lincoln's law partner and biographer, in 1866, and spent 3 days examining the biographical materials he had accumulated, said Thomas Lincoln ill-treated Abraham to such an extent that he drove him from home. Augustus H. Chapman deplored Thomas's great barbarity in dealing with his boy. Dennis Hanks recalled that Thomas would whip young Abe for minor indiscretions. "Sometimes Abe was a little rude," Hanks testified. When strangers would ride along and up to his father's fence, Abe always, through pride and to tease his father, would be sure to ask the stranger the first question, for which his father would sometimes knock him a rod. Thomas Lincoln would pick up a big clod and knock little Abe off the fence, crying, "Let older people have the first say, will you, boy?" Whenever he was whipped by his father, he never bawled, but dropped a kind of silent, unwelcome tear, as evidence of his sensations, or other feelings. Thomas avoided whipping or scolding his son in front of visitors, but would administer punishment after they had left. One day, a poor neighbor named Jenkins, who usually went barefoot, called on the Lincolns. Abe greeted him heartily. Hello, Mr. Jenkins. You are doing better than you used to. You have a new pair of boots. Thomas took his son aside and gave Abe a little drilling, because his remarks may have wounded Jenkins's feelings. Well, said Abe, he's got the boots. Lincoln's cousin Sophie Hanks always said that the worst trouble with Abe was when people was talking. If they said something that wasn't right, Abe would up and tell them so. Uncle Tom had a hard time to break him of this. She also recalled how Lincoln very often would correct his father in talking when his father was telling how anything happened and if he didn't tell it just right or left out anything, Abe would butt in right there and correct it. Thomas would then slap the lad. Abe was physically punished for other kinds of misbehavior, too. He received a beating, for instance, when he released a bear cub from one of Thomas's traps. Lincoln's father regarded physical strength as sufficient to make a manly man and thought time spent on schooling was wasted. He would slash Abe for neglecting his work by reading. Sometimes he even threw out the boy's books. 5 years after Lincoln, at the age of 22, left his father's home, Thomas Lincoln scoffed, I suppose that Abe is still fooling himself with education. I tried to stop it, but he got that fool idea in his head and it can't be got out. Now, I ain't had no education, but I get along far better than if I had. Thomas then showed how he kept his accounts by marking a rafter with a piece of coal, and proudly declared, that there's a heap better than your education. He added that, if Abe don't fool away all his time on his books, he may make something yet. Mother Nancy. Lincoln's estrangement from his father is well documented, but little is known about his relationship with his mother, who died when Abe was just 9 years old. In fact, little is known about her at all. She was born in Virginia around 1783 or 1784. Accounts of her appearance differ widely. Her complexion was variously described as dark, sandy, pale, and exceedingly fair, while her hair was deemed light by some and dark by most. Her eyes were evidently hazel, though one observer described her as a heavy-built, squatty woman. Most people remembered her as taller than average. One estimate placed her at 6 feet. She had a spare, delicate frame, weighed about 120 pounds, and was not at all good-looking, with a face sharp and angular, high forehead, and rather coarse features that gave her the appearance of a laboring woman. A minister who interviewed people who knew the Lincolns in Indiana said she was about 5 feet 10 inches tall, bony, angular, and lean, with long arms, large ears, nose and mouth, small gray-blue eyes, and a big head and a long stringy neck. Her cheekbones were high, and her chest was sunken. Nancy Hanks was evidently an intelligent, kind woman. Her son called her intellectual and a woman of genius. Dennis Hanks agreed, praising her quick perception and good memory. Nathaniel Grigsby said she was noted throughout the family for her strong mind and was a brilliant woman, far superior to her husband in every way. She was notably affectionate and displayed tenderness, charity, and love to the world. Her cheerful disposition and active habits were a dower to the pioneers with whom she lived. She also enjoyed a reputation for outdoing all the local women at spinning flax. At camp meetings, the deeply religious Nancy would shout in an attempt to get others to repent. She was not very sociable, however. She did not talk much, nor did she visit with her neighbors. They, in turn, stopped coming to see her because she did not return their calls. Her lack of sociability may have been linked to her apparent sadness, even depression. Neighbors remembered her sad appearance and observed that she was rather gloomy. Her son Abraham, her relative John Hanks, and Indiana neighbors all commented on her melancholy. A Kentuckian attributed her depression and aloofness to gossip. People talked about her sometimes, and that depressed her. Hurt her. Those hurtful rumors perhaps concerned the unchaste ways of Nancy's mother, Lucy Hanks, who bore Nancy out of wedlock in Virginia and was later charged with fornication in Kentucky. At first, Lucy turned baby Nancy over to her own parents. Later, the youngster was raised by her childless aunt and uncle, Thomas and Elizabeth Sparrow. She also lived for a time with Richard Berry and his wife, Polly Ewing Berry, friends of Thomas Lincoln. Her mother's lack of interest in her may have predisposed Nancy to depression. That she was base-born was well known in Indiana, and probably common knowledge in Kentucky, too. Questions were raised about Nancy Hanks's chastity as well as her mother's. Polly Richardson, a neighbor of the Lincolns in both Kentucky and Indiana, told her daughter that not only was Nancy Hanks an illegitimate child herself, but that Nancy was not what she ought to have been, that she was loose. Among the people who believed this of Nancy, Judge Alfred M. Brown of Elizabethtown reported that rumor says that Nancy Hanks had one child before she married Thomas Lincoln, a son, the father of whom was Isaac Friend. Others called her of low character, a woman who did not bear a very virtuous name. William H. Herndon believed that Nancy Hanks fell in Kentucky about 1805, fell when unmarried, fell afterward. According to Herndon, the reputation of Mrs. Lincoln is that she was a bold, reckless, daredevil kind of a woman, stepping to the very verge of propriety. Nancy Hanks's wayward behavior may have inspired the story that in a fair wrestle she could throw most of the men who ever put her powers to the test. Jack Thomas, clerk of the Grayson County Court, alleged that he had frequently wrestled with her, and she invariably laid him on his back. Nancy's courtship with Thomas Lincoln raised some eyebrows. At the time they met, she was living in the home of a woman on South Fork Creek where Thomas Lincoln often came to visit. The young couple would take extensive trips to attend camp meetings and would stay out quite late, scandalizing the neighborhood. Finally, the woman with whom Nancy was staying scolded Thomas for such nocturnal adventures. This reprimand may have prompted Nancy to move temporarily to Washington County and later to marry Tom there, instead of in her adopted home. Other sources, perhaps describing the same woman, testify that Nancy lived with various families in Bourbon County, sewing, weaving, and doing domestic work, and that while there she was courted by Thomas Lincoln, whose shiftless character caused her friends to think him not worthy of her. A neighbor unrelated to Nancy, a good, kind old lady, a motherly sort of woman, took a great interest in Nancy and grew upset because the young woman got herself talked about from allowing this shiftless Linkhorn to wait on her. The woman persuaded Nancy to go to Washington County with some of her relatives in the Berry family, who were attending a camp meeting nearby. She agreed, but if the plan was to get her away from Tom Lincoln, it failed, for he clambered into the wagon and accompanied her. Some felt that Nancy was not a wanton woman, but a victim of idle gossip. Nancy Lincoln Brumfield, Thomas Lincoln's sister, asserted that Nancy Hanks was more sinned against than sinning. Mrs. Brumfield explained that Nancy visited Elizabethtown when Tom Lincoln was absent, causing tongues to wag. County folk in that era believed that women should remain at home and work. William H. Herndon observed that the noblest of women can lose their character quickly in a little village or in a new and sparsely settled country. Everybody knows everybody, and a man's business is the business of the whole community. Such people love to tattle and lie about one another. Stories about Nancy's unsavory reputation, accurate or not, evidently reached the ears of her son, Abe, and made him ashamed of her and of her family. Herndon ascribed Lincoln's melancholy in part to his sensitivity about the origin and chastity of his near and dear relations, and speculated that Lincoln may have felt suicidal because of the knowledge of his mother's origin. Lincoln was informed of all this, Herndon believed. Probably it was thrown up to him in Indiana. Herndon reported that Lincoln remembered the scorn of her neighbors. J. Edward Murr, an Indianan, who interviewed several Hoosier acquaintances of the Lincolns, speculated that Abraham early knew that his mother was an illegitimate, and this troubled him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.